Hello and welcome to Ivy Times TV. I'm Marisa Christian. Today I'm joined by Bob Horvath, Global Chairman and CEO of RAP, one of the world's largest marketing services agencies. Bob, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
What is driving growth in marketing and advertising agencies right now?
Right now, I would say it's primarily three things. It's the business leadership, which is something that's very important for our clients right now to really understand what their business problems are and how agencies are trying to solve them. The second is innovation, which is all about integrating and connecting all of the different social networks, the search, the platforms that a lot of companies have developed, and putting them all together in order to create some better brand consumer relationships between the two so we can drive the growth for the clients' businesses. And the third is accountability. Accountability has always been a huge basis for our business. Accountability and measurability is all about how we can associate and attribute what we do in the marketplace with revenue growth and with customer acquisition and retention and optimization, which ultimately is what every business is in business for, is to help them grow their business. So it's primarily those three things that we see continuing to be at the forefront of what our clients are looking for. CEOs and CMOs are increasingly under the gun for results, and measurable results ultimately is what they're being held accountable for. So that's where we like to play with our business. That's where we see our clients really succeeding. So that's where we see the business going forward.
I read an article from Adweek that claims digital advertising growth will outpace traditional ad revenue growth. Why is that?
Well, digital is where everybody does search, where everybody starts the consumer brand experience. Traditional advertising is still a very large part of every company's advertising spend. The growth will continue to be heavily in digital. Pretty much at least half of all new business pitches are heavily digitally based. But still, the substantial amount of money is still in traditional advertising. The growth will continue to be there, especially with social networks being huge. Search will continue to play a big part. It's going to continue to grow, and it's a challenge for many advertisers because the revenue model is very different. The old agency models were based on traditional TV spend and percentages of TV spend. Digital production, digital cost of space is not as expensive. So the revenue model needs to change. Our business, fortunately, has always been about basically architecting and engineering the solution. The medium and the channels that we use really are irrelevant to us because our business model is based on providing the solution, a strategic solution that we implement through whatever channels we need to in order to make the results happen.
I saw that RAP collaborated with AMC Theaters to sort of redesign its brand through virtual movie ticket stubs. Explain the thought process there.
It was very interesting. The whole notion of the emotional connection between the paper stub that you get from a movie theater and what that means to people through the timeline of their lives. So their first movie with their children, their first date movie, some meaningful event that happened in the world. These things all had a place, and we found a very strong emotional connection. So we designed the program with them. They had a loyalty program in place, but we said this whole notion of the stub and what making it online a virtual memory place for connections of people with their families and their friends and being able to just share all that became just such an overwhelming success for them. And the results were just phenomenal compared to what we had expected it to achieve. And we're very proud of it. It was a very emotionally strong concept. And the employees and leadership of AMC really took it to heart, and they celebrated it. They brought it to all of their theaters and their employees, and it really turned out to be just a phenomenal event. So we're really, really excited about it.
That's excellent. What is the industry outlook moving forward, or more importantly, where do you see it going?
The industry, interestingly, there's the typical couple of things, which is digital continuing to be a very strong part of everybody's spend and everybody's experience with the consumer. Globalization will continue to be a strong driver of consolidation with agencies, and especially through procurement and big companies who are looking to, you know, save some money and consolidate agency relationships. Those two, I would kind of put those on the side, but the three, I'd say, more specialized areas that I think are very important for everybody to consider. The first is kind of the changing demographics of society. You know, the boomers are now starting to hit 65. They will be starting to, you know, retire. So obviously leisure, travel, you know, financial planning, all of those things will become more important. And then you have this other phenomenon of the millennials coming in, 70 plus million strong in the U.S., you know, 20 plus percent of the population. And that demographic pretty much is consistent globally. And they represent some interesting things. They're highly educated. They are tech savvy. They are very brand loyal. And at the same time, they're hard to engage. They are hard to convince. They are somewhat hard to kind of nail down. And by the way, they represent $170 billion worth of purchasing power.
No big deal.
No big deal. So when you look at that, you say, how do you engage with them? At the same time, 80% of them have two devices open at any given point in time, at least. So they might be on their smartphone, they might be on the computer, they might be on TV, they might be interacting with their friends on Facebook or on any other Twitter or anything else that they're doing. So how do you engage them when you need responses very quickly and engagement very quickly? And you can't be found out. You have to be sincere and genuine to your brand. So we look a lot at kind of the value of values, you know, brand values, which in the past, it used to be the brand would be what the company said it was. Now we believe it's what the consumer says it is, what people say it is. And in a time where everything's pretty virtual, everything is very real time, you really have to make sure that you're optimizing and engaging on a real-time basis, because you can't just float something out there and then walk away and say, okay, we'll come take a look at it in a week, a month, 2 months, because so many things happen so quickly. I don't know if you saw yesterday in Australia, Facebook had a ruling that basically said that any company that has a Facebook page, a corporate Facebook page, they are responsible for the content on that. So if you put content on a corporate Facebook page in Australia and it's wrong, the company is responsible for correcting that and making sure it's right. So think of the implications of that when it relates to a brand, for monitoring it, making sure that the content is genuine, accurate, fact-based. I mean, that's just a lot of implications there that I think will happen more and more as the social networks evolve, as it continues to have more influence, because otherwise it can get out of hand. And once it gets out of hand, you know, it's hard to wheel back in. So you really have to manage that very closely. And I think companies are starting to realize that. They're getting more comfortable because I think they're realizing that it's something you can't keep in a very tight swim lane. You have to give it room to move around, but you have to still keep it somewhat in the area where you want it to be, or else it can go pretty far askew and end up causing some damage that you didn't want it to have.
Well, like you said, it comes back down to accountability.
Yes, yes, yes. And then the second big thing is innovation. Sorry, I kind of went off long on that the first part. The innovation part is tying together all of these networks and the platforms and making sure the experiences are real time and are innovative to address those issues. And then the final one would be big data. And big data we hear a lot about. Big data, again, when you look at things like YouTube and how much data that uses up. You look at Facebook with, you know, a billion people on it now. You look at Twitter, you look at all of these data feeds, and they're being pulled together to generate insights and trying to understand what's happening from a from a more of a tribal or cultural perspective. These things take a lot to really understand and a lot to put together. So big data in and of itself is data, and it's, you know, Google's got a lot of data. How you use it and how you pull it together and how you use it for garnering insights and making sure that you are leveraging the power of it is the hard part. It's turning the data into insights, turning it into knowledge, and then applying it to what you want it to achieve is really where the challenge comes in. And I think that those companies who can really leverage the big data component of all of this information will win. We look a lot at cultural trends, cultural insights into what's driving behavior. Again, getting back to what I said before about the kind of value of values. If a brand's values are inconsistent with what their experience is and what they're actually doing in the marketplace, you're outed very quickly. So you really have to start with, is there alignment there? And if there's not alignment there, you're heading down a road that's not going to end up in a pretty place. So I think that's a pretty critical part too. So those are kind of the three things I think are pretty important going forward.
You said something pretty interesting. I'm going off the script here. Mm-hmm. I read a book called What Would Google Do? And I feel like when Google first came out, it was one of the first times that instead of saying, this is our brand, this is our image, this is what we are, they let the people say, this is what you are, this is what we want. Mm-hmm. And that's why they were so successful. Yes. Coming from an advertising point of view, that must have been a dramatic shift in your method.
Yeah, I think if you look at two models, you look at Google and you look at Apple. I mean, those two have contrasted so many times as Apple being very command and control, a driver of this is the solution, now you go use it, as opposed to Google, which was very much a collaborative, built up solution, built up culture. They're much more collaborative, much more of a decentralized organization. Apple, very, very hierarchical. Both good in their own way. You just have to make sure that you align the whole organization that way. Google's been phenomenally successful, and I think they will continue to be. The whole search aspect of everybody's life will continue to play a very strong part of a business. I think they're going to do well for a very long time, and I think it's a great model.
We're not worried about Google, right?
No, I mean, and it's a tool. It's a platform. I think the only thing that they run the risk of is really that proliferation of data to the point where you do a search and unfortunately you end up with having to sift through a lot of information that otherwise is irrelevant. And right. And I think the more they can build artificial intelligence, and they're certainly doing a lot of this, but I think the more sophisticated they can get in developing truly what you're looking for from a connectivity standpoint, that's where the power will ultimately be, and I think that'll give them even further exponential growth.
Right.
So, force to be reckoned with for sure.
Absolutely. We are in the midst of the Olympics. Mm-hmm. What effect, if any, does such a large global event have on the advertising and marketing sectors?
Well, you got the quadrennial effect, which is the Olympics and the presidential election. So, that has a big impact. If you look at the impact of those two, the numbers I see are anywhere between $5 and $7 billion of incremental ad spending just during that 5-month period of kind of June through November, May through November, that type of time frame. That's 5 months, right? and it's a big deal. It's a big deal because a lot of people try out a lot of new things during the Olympics. Not so much during the elections, but during the Olympics, you see a lot more talk about Twitter, a lot more talk about who's popular on Facebook. You see a lot more information coming out that otherwise you wouldn't have seen in the past, and especially in places like China, and India, and Brazil, you see a lot more of their ability to communicate and get the information out there real time. And I think that's great. I think those things are really allowing the Olympics, which is a global event, to really become even more global. And I think it's been a, I happen to love the Olympics anyway, but I think it's been a really good Olympics from that standpoint. I think the amount of excitement and communication around it has been has been better than it's ever been. So
you'd say it's more experimental time for advertising.
I think so, because it used to be, at least as long as I can remember, you watch on TV, and they'd show you some updates. You'd maybe catch the late night replays of certain things, and that was it. Now there's a lot more streaming, a lot more real time. You can pretty much, you see what's happening, really. You have to shut things off so you don't see what's happening.
The time zones are a problem.
Time zones are a big problem. and so I think that's an interesting part. And again, it's not that it's good or bad. I happen to think it's good, but you have to be able to deal with it in a way that makes it so it's being beneficial to what you're trying to accomplish. So that whole connected world, the whole what type of information you're getting out there, again, has to be monitored, has to be, I'll say managed, bad word, but has to be kind of curated a little bit more so it comes out in a way that you want it to represent what you want it to represent.
Well, that was very informative. Bob, thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, thank you very much, Marisa. It was great meeting you.
I'm Marisa Christian with Ivy Times TV.